Manuel, I'll start with you for As Without, So Within. Could you start off by talking about the objects that we're looking at in the film?
Yeah, sure. It was really nice protection, actually. Thank you for watching. Is this on? Yeah? Yeah?
Yeah, can you hear?
The objects are sculptures that I made based on drawings that I made based on... I was trying to understand what would construct an abstract image and how different elements could mean something. And so there were thoughts around what abstraction might be in terms of form and color. And a lot of these thoughts would come from other films that I was watching, because I was particularly interested in trying to understand how the relationship with something abstract was in terms of moving image. And I think at first it was just ideas and drawings. And then I realized that I had to make them because I couldn't find those things and I didn't want to rely on optical distortion to create abstraction. And I was also in like America, suburbia, Santa Clarita. It didn't really feel like I had much things to have that kind of image. And so I decided to make them, and I came from art background, so I was used to making, and I knew I could get something. And they're plaster that I use condoms. I put them inside, and they're like these quite small objects, and then with watercolor and pigment. So they're kind of sculptural thoughts, yeah.
So you made them yourself. Was it important to you to make them yourself to kind of maintain that level of abstraction as opposed to finding objects and maybe people can then apply additional meanings to them?
Mm. I've done things based on finding something before. But in this one time, it felt like it was important exactly that they were abstract to the level that they didn't come with carried connotations, you know? So if it was, like I've done things before where it was a tube of PVC that I found on the floor, that came with its own ideas, and I didn't want anything to be from our world or figurative in that respect. I was really trying to understand how, because I had never done a film before, and film in itself was a complicated thing, and I wanted it to be abstract, so I was really trying to go back to what basic, so that I could see what was doing what effect and what was acting out. So,
how much experience with film did you have as you were getting into this project?
With film as in with celluloid, none. And with video, maybe a year before of work, very little.
How much did that contribute to the experimentation of actually the process of making this film?
I think that's all it is. I think the beginning of the film is the beginning of my working with film, and the end of the film is the end of it. So in that sense, you can see it a bit of as an essay film. Like, that's why the beginning, the editing, there's this lack of confidence, and as I discovered thoughts on filmmaking, I would add them later. Very few times I went back and edit a little bit.
So how long did it take you to make this film?
2 years.
Filming 2 years?
No, actually filming was like an afternoon. Filming was an afternoon because it was my first film. I made really bad decisions throughout, which got me into some really weird problems that also determined the structure. Like my idea, because I didn't want, also thinking the abstract and thinking the mind and how our mind and observation can, some things come alive, you know. You can have a single take where nothing happens, and because your thought changes the image, it's as if the image is changing. So I didn't want any notion of animation to be from camera move, light move, or hand. In that way, editing, it's kind of like caved, you could say. But so I knew that there were going to be long takes where nothing happens. And so there wasn't no need to film them for a very long time. So I just, each take was 4 seconds of film. And then my idea was to go to the optical printer and loop it. And then I like study the image, which it, definitely that from the beginning I wanted to do. So I got a bad Telecine, a like low quality Telecine with the coding, and I started editing. But because I had never done that before and I didn't do film before, and I don't really respect these serious workflows and software ways of using, I couldn't care less. Like I drag and drop and change and export again and bring it back in if it's gonna make it easier to not look at so many cuts. I totally lost my MA linking and my referral of coding, and I also suddenly I had thousands of edits and I zoomed in so much the optical printer could have never zoomed in that much. I kind of forgot my own parameters, and I just found myself in an absolute problem that there was no way I could take it back to film that way. I also did tests with the OP and it just didn't look good. So those two things kind of were something that made me decide. I went back to film by shooting off a TV with I put the 16 and I shot off a TV with a teacher in CalArts that he used to do. He gives video graphics, so like the beginning of VJing with cables and so on. So he has a great technique of bringing it back to film. So actually the shooting was one afternoon, very short, 300 feet, and afterwards it was just editing for 2 years.
Could you talk about the sound of the film? For much of it, it's this sort of pink noise, but every so often there are these kind of little melodic kind of sounds.
So the sound was done by my sister. She's amazing. She's younger than me, and she's an electronic musician and singer. And she had never done sound work for any film. But she was the only person I could trust to do it because she knows my work since always, and the dialogue is there. So if I express something, she would pick up on it well. And this was a film that it wanted to be abstract, but then it started becoming a very strong sponge for iconic figurative ideas like out of space, planetary things, or archaeological bones and stuff like. So I was seeing all these things start to happen. It also looked like a tribute to modernism, and I just didn't understand why that was happening. So I was like, I'm not gonna put some sort of jazzy, experimental, like tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk sound. I'm not gonna put either some sort of very sci-fi thing, because it's gonna push it in the spatial stuff. I'm not gonna put. Instruments were difficult because instruments hold the spaces, material objects in the world themselves, like a guitar, a flute, you know, they have, which I love, but they also had a thing. So as soon as you put a sound music object, like drum or something, it would just make something really bizarre, which interesting at moments. And I wanted the sound that wasn't perceivable, but that would help the body have some surrounding support, so you're able to go into the film a little bit quicker and you don't waste the first 5 times being so tense in your body. Like my intention was not to make people, it's not that they can't struggle, they can struggle, but yeah, I thought that specific sensation was not interesting. And I wanted it to be a sound that evoked the space. Like a lot of the decisions are reflections on the cinematic experience. So the objects are still and they don't move because you as a body in the space are still and cannot move. A lot of the framing, it like refers to the framing of the screen. The objects have black around them because you have black around you in the theater. And I was just trying to test if this thing could create a field of sympathy with abstraction and take you to relation. Like it was a test. Like, does that talk more to one if there are not a mirror but something like this? So the sound, I wanted to be a little bit talking of the floor of film sound, but also the room tone, and we wanted a continuum, and we also were worried about sounds like potential to make strong narrative on something, so we had to be very subtle with it. But because the objects are finite, then sound, we also thought it as finite. And cinema is so important, the moment where sync sound was discovered, and how that creates like a fourth field dimension, you know, like it's like as soon as, like maybe you're in a world of sync, and when you saw the object sync, it's like it does this piercing moment. And so I wanted to kind of have a little bit about that, but also make it uncomfortable and just resent the film somehow for not giving you that, but because of that, then meaning that you have a double experience, like the experience of its lack and its the desire of it, which in itself is like you are already leaving it because you wanted it, so you know what something together would sound. And it was a way as well to talk about the here and now, and make the, we thought that it could help the audience bring it back to the image. They're like some sort of wipes or refreshers, because, I mean, I love it when you're in a film and you go in and out, and I think it's totally cool to fall asleep in a film and wake up from a film, and you don't have to be thinking about the film all the time for that to be the relationship with it. And you can think about the breakup that you just had, or the struggle, or your own projects. And I think that's a nice thing about sitting and watching experimental films, is it's also a time for you, with you. But you can go very far, no? Sometimes. So the finite sound was like a little bit like remembering it, that is what you're living. You're seeing this film, and it's about these objects. And then Camila, the actual sounds that she chose, she made these little synthesizers, and I would have never gone the humorous route, for example, with those cluck, tuk, tuk, tuk. But then when she sent them to me, I was like, yeah, that's nice, it's light, you know? I was like, thank God, because otherwise this thing was looking so pretentious, you know, for a moment.
Yeah, it gives it a sense of humor.
Yeah, and I have to say, because he's here, Freddie, he made the titles. A good friend of mine, and they also have a little secret to them. The sizes of the title cards respect this idea of the field sizes in the animation stand. So there are all these little secrets inside of it, just to try to understand film.
Charlotte, on the topic of sound.
What?
On the topic of sound, I guess I'd like to start off with a straightforward question. How did you come to this place, the ghost mining towns in La Pampa?
Thank you all for staying. I'm going to switch in French because I'm not so comfortable in English. So, comment je suis arrivée là, c'est ça? J'ai voyagé une première fois au Chili, j'ai rencontré une personne absolument magnifique qui a voulu me donner sa culture ouvrière et qui a voulu me l'offrir, qui m'a chanté entièrement la cantate. Et on a été ensemble, enfin pour mon anniversaire, comme un cadeau. Et on a été ensemble dans le désert, parce qu'elle avait une conférence là-bas, une conférence d'histoire, sur un groupe militant des années 50 au Chili. Et on y allait comme des touristes, en fait. Et c'est à ce moment-là, en ressentant que malgré le fait que ce lieu soit un musée, et soit un musée à la mémoire nationale des ouvriers, pas du tout sur ce qui s'est passé, c'est pas du tout un musée à la mémoire de cet événement, de ce massacre, c'est plutôt la famille Pampine, comme la familia Pampina típica, comme l'honneur de la région. Et voilà. Et du coup... mon amie, elle était, enfin, elle présentait quelque chose en fait. Et
so she traveled to Chile, where she met a magnificent person that brought her into being conscious about the working class culture in Chile. And for her birthday, they were into a conference that her friend was participating in. And in her birthday, her girlfriend. Some kind of girlfriend introduced her to these songs.
Yes.
And somehow she was telling that she was feeling like a tourist at that moment of the
in the Pampas,
that somehow looks like a museum for the memory of these working class people that were oppressed and killed in this landscape.
Could you talk about the actual cantata, what that means to Chilean history?
Mm-hmm. The cantata is a symbol of communism culture in Chile, because the group was a cultural ambassador when Allende was the president before the state coup d'état.
Yeah, you can say it in French.
Hmm?
You can say it in French.
Coup d'état, yeah,
yep.
Before the coup d'état. Oh, it's a French word, yeah, okay. Cool. nice discovery. The actual event, it's a very strong popular symbol of struggle. And the cantata, it's an actualization of that in the 70s. And now it's kind of a rest of that kind of feeling of struggle. And, you know, in Chile, people are, how to say that? Il y a une sorte de mélange entre quelque chose de pathétique, de romantique, de très incarné et de très en lutte, quoi.
Yeah, they're in Chileans have this very romantic approach.
Not romantic, but just pathetic,
it can be. It's pathetic, but yeah, in a sort of inland,
yes,
of the spirit of their struggle.
Yeah.
Somehow, and they like a hurting feeling that it mixes with a melancholia somehow.
Yeah,
and the cantata, I think it's it's now a basis of this history. And you have to know, in Chile, the dictature is not called dictature in school and everything. It's just military government, something like that. So the cantata is popular. Everybody knows that, but it's also separate people, like people pro Pinochet now, there is a lot, and the other, just however it's dead, but there is a lot of people. But for me, it's not all that sick because I'm French, so for me, it's my friend was Chilean, my sort of girlfriend, and we met each other in some kind of incandescence. How to say that? Fire burning.
Yeah.
We were fire together, and she always called me like, "You are a bourgeois, Charlotte. You have to learn about." And I say, "Ah, you have to learn about feminism and these two things mixed in the cantata," because she has this viral thing about communism and struggle, and I think my poro is more like about sharing pain and sharing. Femininity in a diva show way. So it was the two things mixed up for me. I'm not pretending I'm speaking about Chilean history. I'm speaking about that meeting between Chilean people and me. And also my friend died. My friend who presented me, who introduced me with the cantata. So it was mixing my intimacy story with her, and she sang me that song, like cutting my hair like that and screaming at me during 40 minutes. And I was like, whoa, this thing is strong, so I have to do something. And after she died, and I decided to be her ghost or something. I think that's why the first part is so ghosting, like, too, because I'm her ghost in a way. And I'm not pretending to speaking about Chilean history, more about how is it to mix sort of diva show of pain, but without being like a grotesque or something, just the artificiality of that and precarity of the makeup and everything. Everything is shown like fragile. The fragility could be a powerness or something. And we can have all that thing together. I think it's the point about.
Yeah, you kind of introduce these sort of camp or burlesque elements mm-hmm. in the film, but you also maintain a kind of rigorous form in kind of framing the landscape and kind of capturing the actual history of the area and sort of your place within it. So I think you're actually very reverent to the subject, but did you have doubts as you were filming it and sort of as you were...
No, never. I had doubts, but not about that. About me in the film, yes. I have doubts. I always have doubts about me in the film because it was sort of an obligation, a weird obligation. It was a peso.
A heavy burden.
Yes, and c'est toujours le cas, je sais pas.
Forever, like for in every moment of the shooting, she had this heavy burden on her.
Yeah.
To struggle with.
Exactly. Thank you. No, exactly. And there was that thing. Like, I was exhausted. I was like, I can't do it. I am a bad singer. I want not to do it. But about mixing that two things, it's my life, you know. I'm from anarchism, and I discover queerness, camp, later. And it saved my life, basically. So... for me, it's more than I don't know. It's more than a posture. It's a way of living, and I'm always between that two culture. And the thing with the cantata for me, the thing very strong about that cantata, it's that thing always with communist men. They are like crying, you know. It's not just we are very real and struggling, and no, they are crying. There is something very sentimental about all of that. And there is a lot of voice in the cantata, like high voice. And there is that song, Vamos Mujer. It's like, go girls. And it's the center of the thing. So I take that song, I say, if it's the center, I have to make this the center of my point of this film. And I met also Arcana, who died, and Grisel, the one in purple in the film. And she is a feminist communautaire. Feminista comunitaria.
Yeah, like a community feminist.
Yes, and but from labor class, and she says that thing to me the first day of shooting, the second part, like, I don't want people to folklorize my history, like, bad white girl. And I was like, okay, yeah, it's right, you know? And because she was not used to of all that show thing, and I say to her, like, for me, struggling has to be a fucking show, has to be something bright and strong and joyful, and that's the thing, I think. So in that kind of thing, it's like, for me, Eisenstein is camp, in a way. He was gay. It's true. But that kind of virgin like that kind of posture of communism, convocating calls Christian iconography, but also like kind of feminine way of crying the thing out. And for me, it's very important that thing. It's just, well, yeah, it's my life, basically.
I think we have some time for questions in the audience, if there are any. Oh, yes, in the middle. So the question's for Manuela, asking about the video element of the film.
Yes, so I filmed on film, then I Telecine got it digital. I did the editing digital. And then I got a second Telecine, higher quality. And because the first one was really, really, really low. And then I copied the edit in the high quality, and I made a QuickTime movie. And I played it in a monitor with a 16 millimeter camera filming the screen. So, and then I went through all the film process, AB rolling, because it was several tins and sound and everything. And this is a 35 print, but this, so that's for the 16 print, which is the main one. The 35, it's a company in London called CPC. They're amazing to work with, extremely cheap. Like the entire film was £400 with shipment included. And they do it in 10 days. And they're a company that does printing on 35. I mean, it's something that's just appeared a little bit. I think they mainly do archival work, but among filmmakers, suddenly it's interesting because it means that you can have your object in your film in an object form, and not as expensive.
Yes, in the back, right there. Question is about casting a man in drag as one of the figures in the film.
Sergei is not a man. not in that case. He has like two identity. So, and this is one of her identity. But I will respond to your question. Because it was not a decision to cast a man, because I knew about this double identity first, and second, they are all friends of my friends who died, so it was a community in that way too. And third, for me now, I think femininity is not about sex, genital sex, or biology, or I don't know, gender. It's gender, obviously, but it's more quality. And I would want to have that thing in my film. The what is the quality of feminine, femme? It's gesture, it's some kind of powerness but fragile, it's I don't know, it's a way of sharing pain and struggling at the same time, it's a kind of force, it's that powerness who come from the anger to be oppressed or compressed in something as a body. And I think for all that reason, it was more interesting ever. However, it was not a decision like cast decision, but to have not just a cis woman in the film. Because for me, feminine, it's also thing like your sex. So it's a little bit, for me, my reference is that of in my heart is, you know, Werner Schröter? No, it's a German cineast, and he did all. You cannot know if the person you saw is transgender, is this woman, is they're all passing, like they're freed with that, but emotion pass through kind sort of femininity in general, emotion and political posture. That's a response.
I'm afraid we have to wrap up for the next screening, unless there's one more question. Yes, right here.
This is the question. They are like that. I'm sorry, I didn't color it like Antonioni. It was like that. It's a protect forest. It's not actually the real port, they are speaking about a port, yes. They are speaking about a port in the cantata, and I imagine some kind of fantasy port, because it's not the port now, it's a commercial horrible port, so it was not good for me. And it's c'est un espace protégé, un parc protégé.
Yeah, like a reservoir. It's a protected space.
Yeah, and we discover we have always in mind like that thing with blood. I think it's my vampire science fiction reference, and we discover that place like, oh, there is blood on the tree. It's amazing. The trees are bleeding. That's something, and we decided to shoot there. But it was like that. It's incredible. It's an incredible place, I think. That's it.
Okay, Manuela, Charlotte, Matthias, thank you so much. Thank you for your films.